Okay, so guys, my name is Andrew Yang. I know I organize these Bitcoin meetups, but for my full-time job, for where I make money, is I work at Casa as a client services manager. And so Casa is a multisig wallet provider. But what I want to do for today is just talk about multisig in general, all right? And so just quick poll, how many of you guys have heard what multisig is? Raise your hands. Okay, yeah, okay, almost everyone, that's awesome. Okay, but now here's my next question. How many of you guys actually use multisig for your security? Okay, well, yeah. You don't have to talk to yourself. If you did it right, you can say it. No, I'm just joking. I'm joking. Okay, cool. Well, let me just pitch you guys on this idea of like multisig and why I think it's important. So let's go to the next slide. All right, so the year is 2030, all right? USD is going through hyperinflation. The world is going to like hell, but you guys have Bitcoin. You guys have Bitcoin, and if you have Bitcoin, you get to live in the Bitcoin Citadel, all right? The Bitcoin Citadel, have you guys heard of it? It's just like, yeah, it's like a meme on Twitter, started in Reddit, but it's like this idea that like, you know, those who are hardcore Bitcoiners, those who were able to preserve their wealth long enough, they will have the ability to enter into the Bitcoin Citadel, and the Citadel is like kind of like a utopia, right? The Bitcoin utopia for Bitcoiners. But the next question, let's go to the next slide. But my question is, what if, are you guys securing your wealth long enough with the perspective and the mindset to secure it long enough to get to the Bitcoin Citadel, right? A lot of times people, you know, when they have Bitcoin, they're thinking, oh, I'm going to buy it. And if it hits 100K, I'm going to sell and I'm going to liquidate. If it hits like a million, I'm going to sell and I'm going to liquidate it, right? But what if I told you like, we're going to live in a world where you don't have to liquidate it. We're going to create a circular economy of Bitcoin, right? And in order for us to get there, we've got to hold our Bitcoin long enough to get there, right? And so think about your Bitcoin setup right now. Like, don't tell me what it is. But think about your Bitcoin setup right now. And are you confident that that setup is going to last for the next 5 years, the next 10 years, 20 years, 30 years? What about the next generation for your kids, right? Is your Bitcoin security and your setup secure enough in order to pass on your Bitcoin to your kids, if you guys have it, right? And so what's interesting is that I think for a group of people with such low time preference, right? That's why we bought Bitcoin, because we believe in the long run it's going to do really well. I think a lot of us have a lot of high time preference setups, right? We want to get access to the Bitcoin quickly. We want it to be easy. We don't want to like deal with all the friction and all the like tech and like all the hardware walls that might be required to set up a multisig. Go to the next slide. So in order for us to get to the Bitcoin Citadel in 2040, you have to self-custody, all right? It's not you might have to, or maybe you should self-custody. You have to self-custody, right? If you want to live in the self-sovereign world, and if you want to become more of a sovereign individual, you have to self-custody your Bitcoin, right? But if that's not reason enough, right? There's lots of examples of why you should. If you've been in Bitcoin long enough, and if you study the history, it's ripe and filled with these examples of centralized custodians going under and you losing access to your Bitcoin and you never getting it back. So one of the biggest examples and first examples was Mt. Gox in 2014, right? Mt. Gox was the biggest like Bitcoin trading platform. It was like the Coinbase or the Kraken or the Gemini of the time, right? It got hacked, and then people lost their Bitcoin, and people went through a creditor phase, and now, you know, people are slowly just now starting to get some of their Bitcoin back, a fraction of their Bitcoin back. And then 2018, Quadriga was like the biggest exchange in Canada. It was the most reputable exchange in Canada. Anytime you went on Reddit, on our Bitcoin, and people were like, oh, where should I buy Bitcoin? They always, and they're in Canada, they say Quadriga, right? But Quadriga, I don't know if you guys have been tracking the story. It's crazy, like the CEO just like went to India and like died apparently. Right. And like the Bitcoin was locked in the multisig or something. And like, there's like this whole like ordeal. But the point is, like, all the people like who have their funds in Quadriga, they can't get their crypto up. They can't get their Bitcoin up, right? Because the CEO was gone. And so that's a crappy situation. 2020, Cred. Cred was a lending platform, much like Celsius, much like Gemini just added that, much like BlockFi. It was a lending platform. These lending platforms tend to be very centralized. You send your Bitcoin in there, they take the Bitcoin, they fractionally reserve it, they give it out to traders, or they make like a position like the GBTC premium, and then they hope to bring the Bitcoin back. Cred, that was their business model. Cred, unfortunately, got hacked and lost some Bitcoin. And then in order to make that money back, they took the funds and sent it to an exchange and decided to like play the market and lost money there. And then they gave more money to a third party because they're like, oh, we really need to make our money back. Third party was a scam and they took the money. Guys, this is 2020 and we're trusting our Bitcoin with these people, right? Think about it. And one common thing I want us to see is that Mt. Gox was the biggest exchange. Quadriga was the biggest exchange. 2021 or 2022, who's going to be the biggest exchange? Coinbase, Gemini, we don't know. Just because they're big doesn't mean that they're secure, right? And so all that is to say we have to self-custody our Bitcoin if we want to guarantee that we're going to have it until we reach the Bitcoin Citadel. But here's the problem. Self-custody is hard. Let's be real, right? It's hard. We're so used. We've been conditioned to have everything done for us, whether it's like to our games, to our machines, and to our computers, to everything we use in the house. It's like a lot of stuff is automated for us. Like, we don't want to do it ourselves, but Bitcoin, it requires you to self-custody and become your own sovereign individual. Now, when it comes to security, there's two questions I like to ask. What are you protecting? And what are you protecting? And who are you protecting it from? Those are two key questions to answer as we think about our Bitcoin security and security in general. Because realistically speaking, you can't protect your system or your setup from everyone and anything. It's like pretty impossible. But you can protect it against a lot of edge cases and scenarios, and you can have a lot of layers of redundancy. But let's talk about our next slide, the single key setup. So let's answer the first question. What are you protecting? Most of us in this room, we're protecting single signature Bitcoin wallets, single key Bitcoin wallets, right? Yeah. A key for my presentation, we're going to call a key a seed phrase. And a seed phrase is a list of 24 words. When you guys set up your hardware wallets, do you guys remember writing a list of 24 words? Right? No? Okay. I hope you. Because those words are your backup, okay? So if your hardware wallet ever breaks, if you lose your mobile phone or whatever, you can take your 24 words, stick it inside of another hardware wallet or another Bitcoin software, and you can recover your Bitcoin or your crypto, right? That's easy, it's done. But the problem is that seed phrase is a single point of failure. It's a single point of failure. And so, let's say I think you and I were really close, I trust you, you're like, I think you're my brother, and I show you my seed phrase, and you take a picture of it. You go home. Later that night, I check my Bitcoin wallet. All of a sudden, I realize, oh, shoot, like the Bitcoin's gone. And the reason is because he took a picture of the seed phrase, of the 24 words. He stuck it into a hardware wallet, and then now he had full access and rights to send the Bitcoin somewhere else. Okay. So all that to say is protecting... If your wallet is a single key Bitcoin wallet, it's really hard to protect. Let's go to the next slide. So here are some of the trade-offs of single keys, right? Like we like single keys, but they're so easy to use, right? You only need one signature to send Bitcoin out. So you just need a tap of a button and you send Bitcoin out. It's really easy to, from a UX perspective, it's so easy. And then like to set up, it's like a lot shorter. It's a lot shorter process. But again, the cons are that it's a single point of failure and it's something that we need to be redundant with. And we have to be careful of. So the next slide. So next is we have to. Isn't that one?
Is that the door?
Oh. Yeah. Next one. Yeah. So back to answering this question. Back one slide. Yeah. So back to this question. So what are you protecting a single key from? You're protecting a single key from hackers. You got to protect it digitally. You're protecting it from thieves. You got to protect it physically. You got to hide it and make sure that nobody can easily access it physically. And most importantly, you're protecting it against yourself. You got to idiot-proof your setup, man. A lot of people, I think they try to get too cute and too fancy with their setup, and they end up screwing themselves or shooting themselves in the foot. Well, let's go to the next slide. All right, so when we think about single key wallets, it's helpful to frame that the types of wallets that people use are can be classified as hot wallets and cold wallets, right? Hot wallets, just very briefly, it means that it's connected to the internet, right? So your mobile phone is a hot wallet. If you have a Bitcoin wallet on your computer, that's a hot wallet, right? But if you have a hardware wallet, that's considered a cold wallet. Cold wallet means your seed phrase is completely separated from the internet and it's cold, it's not hot. And so examples of cold wallets are paper wallets and hardware wallets. And we want to shoot for cold wallets because what that means is that the digital hackers, to protect it digitally, they're not going to be able to access the internet from a remote location and steal your Bitcoin because your keys, your seed phrases are cold, they're offline. Next slide. And so let's talk about how do we protect these hardware wallets? Well, with your hardware wallets, you got to either hide it or you got to stick it in a vault, right? But even if you do that, there's no guarantee that like somebody's not going to come across it accidentally, right? If you put it in a bank safety deposit box, who's to tell you that a bank employee isn't just going to open it up with the master key and just, oh, shoot, here's a hardware wallet, and they just take it home, right? You don't know that. You don't know that's going to happen. And if you hide it, I don't know, maybe you forgot where you put your hardware wallet, right? And here's one thing for people to consider. With hardware wallets, yes, they are secure. Like, I don't want to freak everyone out. Yes, they are secure. But with enough time and enough resources, any hardware wallet can be broken, right? With enough time and enough resources, any hardware wallet can be broken. That's a fact. So think about that when it comes to your digital security. So you got to protect the hardware wallets. You've also got to protect your seed phrase, right? So a lot of people, not only do they have the hardware wallet, but they write it down. They write down the 24 words somewhere on a piece of paper, or maybe they punch it into a steel plate, right? Some people, they're like, that's too risky. If I leave this seed phrase lying around somewhere, someone comes across it, they can like write it down and then they can take your Bitcoin, right? So instead they say, oh shoot, I'm gonna get creative with it. Mm-hmm. So they take your 24 words, maybe they cut it in half or into fours, they give it to four different family members and they say, okay, if I ever die or if I ever forget my seed phrase or whatever, I can recover it that way. But the problem is the order of the seed phrase is really important. Right? If you assemble it in the wrong order, you're not going to get your Bitcoin back. The other one is with the seed phrase is that you got to assume that your families they're still going to talk to each other. Like they're still going to want to like hang out by the time that you recover your Bitcoin. So there's like a social aspect that we've got to account for. Some of the craziest stories I've heard on Reddit, it's pretty funny, is that like some dude wrote a story, and in the story were the words, the seed phrase words. And then he stuck it on his Google Drive and he's like, oh, I have like a math formula to figure out which word is in which paragraph and all that stuff. And then he was like, oh, this is super safe. And he stuck it in Google Drive. Like, I think like 2 months later, like his Bitcoin was gone. So that is not a good idea. Because that's a hot wallet because he stuck a seed phrase in Google Drive. But then there's other things I've heard where like people will take a book and then they'll find a word on a page and the number of the, you know, how many words down the page that word is, and they'll write it on a piece of paper. And so it's like a treasure map. And they're like, oh, if I have this book and I have the page and I have the word word count on the page, then I know where the word is. But like, dude, what if what if you lose a book and it's never printed in that edition again? Like you're kind of screwed, right? So there's a lot of like, I get that like people want to be super creative and super like, complicated when it comes to their setup, but man, by making this so complicated, we are more at risk at shooting ourselves in the foot than somebody else coming across it and taking the Bitcoin. So the next slide. So idiot-proofing, yeah, don't forget where you put it. Don't forget your password or PIN. Like I think y'all heard the New York Times story of some Ripple dude exec who like had Bitcoin in a wallet and then he just forgot his password. And he has like one attempt left, and if he doesn't get it right, then like his Bitcoin's locked forever, right? So that's a Bitcoin wallet, and then they added a password protection software on top of the Bitcoin wallet, and they said you get like 15 attempts. If you don't hit 15 attempts, or if you go past 15 attempts, everything's wiped. I mean, he's kind of screwed, I think, right? Don't forget like how you set up your Bitcoin wallet. So these are all things that we've got to protect ourselves from. So the next slide. Now, what if I told you that there was another way, right? Rather than going through all the hassle of trying to protect your single key, what if there's a better solution? What if there's a more redundant, safe, secure, automatically cold solution to protecting your Bitcoin, right? And what if you could set it up yourself, right? And so that's what multisig is, right? In the previous slide, there was one key, one seed phrase for one Bitcoin wallet. Well, here's an example. This is an example of a 2 of 3 multisig wallet. We're gonna use 3 keys, 3 seed phrases to create one Bitcoin wallet, right? Instead of 1 out of 1, it's 3 out of 1, right? So 3 keys to create one Bitcoin wallet. And not only that, what if we created a special spending condition that said, if I have any combination of two of these keys out of the 3, I can send Bitcoin out. What does that mean? That means if I lose one Bitcoin one seed phrase, if one seed phrase gets compromised, I'm still good, right? I'm still good and I'm still safe. And so immediately there's that built into the system, we have a layer of redundancy by using a 2 of 3 multisig wallet. So let's go to the next slide. So what are the pros? It's redundant, it's flexible, it's secure, and no single point of failure, right? We talked about redundancy. If you lose one, you're still good. You can still send Bitcoin out. But like, let's say you lose one, you can add another key. And when you add another key, you can send Bitcoin from your old multisig wallet to your new multisig wallet. So it's flexible. It's not like once your key is gone, you're kind of stuck there and there's nothing else you can really do. You got to send it all out or whatever, right? Like, it's flexible. If you lose one key, you add another key and you recreate another multisig wallet, send funds to the new one, and you're set and you're done. You're using the same keys. You don't have to destroy the whole setup the whole setup that you did. It's secure, it's safe, it's part of Bitcoin's like native scripting scheme. And so it's not like Ethereum where you create a smart contract that says, oh, you need like 2 signatures from 2 different places. It's natively built into the Bitcoin protocol. So it's very secure and it's open source, right? Even Casa, yes, we are a company and we have private software, but we're really using Bitcoin's open source code for our wallet. And no single point of failure. That's really important, right? So it makes it easier for you to protect your Bitcoin, to get to the Bitcoin Citadel, to keep it safe for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, and to even pass it on to your kids. So next slide. So that just kind of like wraps up my presentation. What I want to do is I want to do a quick demo of setting up a multisig wallet with Casa. It's going to be a 2 of 3, but not only that, I'm going to recreate that multisig wallet using Electrum. And who knows what Electrum is? Electrum is an open source Bitcoin wallet, right? That's not something that Casa touches in any single shape or form. But what you're going to see is that the Bitcoin wallet that we create in the Casa wallet can also be recreated in the Electrum wallet. And the beautiful thing about Bitcoin open source code is that it's reusable, right? You're not locked into one platform. As long as it's open source and as long as it follows the same standards, you can use that software as well. So if Casa ever disappears, you can recreate the multisig inside of Electrum, create the multisig wallet, and send Bitcoin out. Okay. All right. Question.
Is Casa hardware, software, both?
Casa is a mobile app.
Got it.
It's a mobile app. And we use other software, other hardware wallets like Ledger, Trezor, Coldcard, Keystone. That's correct. Yeah. And it's good to consider having hardware wallet diversity when it comes to your multisig wallet as well. Right, because then what happens is, let's say if one Ledger gets supply chain attacked, well then that's fine because you have a Trezor or a Cold Card as another one of your keys. So like you're fine, you're good. Yeah. Yeah. Cool. Any other questions? Go ahead.
Well, I was just gonna say too, the other risk with like the big guys like Coinbase or whatever is that individuals get hacked, like they're just their account, not like everybody lost their shit, just like one person.
Exactly. Yeah. So if your login credential security isn't good, like let's say for your 2FA, you use a phone number instead of Google Authenticator or another TOTP 2FA authentication device, like you're kind of screwed. So like, wait, please don't. If you have SMS on your Coinbase account, like change that ASAP. Go down Google Authenticator and then tie that 2FA to that. You're right. Like it's maybe you get spearfished or phished, and then you give your login credentials to a hacker, and then they can access your Bitcoin and drain it. Like it sucks. Yeah. Go ahead.
I was thinking if you can't keep one seed phrase safe, how the heck are you going to keep three?
Yeah, that's a great question, right? So the reason why it was so difficult to keep one safe is because it's a single point of failure.
I mean, I'm thinking it's the strategy. The strategy of how you're keeping it, that's where the problem is. Because people are freestyle, there is no like I was thinking if I kept it, I'd have like some type of a, you know, like you start with the third word and that's where you start and then it goes on, it rotates, right? And yeah. Somebody can figure that out, right?
Yeah. Yeah, so how someone protects it is very important. But here's the thing. By adding redundancy, you make it more secure. The problem of having a single key setup, no matter how good it is, like it's a single point of failure. If somebody gets those 24 words, you're done. That's it. But by doing a multi-sig, you're adding a layer of redundancy where you're saying, well, I'm prone to make a mistake, so let's just assume I make one. Well, okay, I'm fine, because I still have two of the keys, and that's okay.
Right, so basically you have it in a bunch of different, like how would you hide it? How would you hide your, I mean, what would be a strategy to hide your keys? You have some online, you have some in a book, you have some, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, for me personally, I would use hardware wallets. If I'm running my own setup, I would use hardware wallets. I would keep maybe one at home. I would keep one like in a bank safety deposit box, another one in a private safety deposit box, a vacation home, I'll keep it there. And then maybe one I have with like a family member, right? But you see how each one of those situations, the attack vector is so different, but I can choose to be that flexible. I'm not opening up my Bitcoin to all the attack vectors. I'm just opening up one key to that attack vector. Right.
Yeah.
And so it's beautifully simple where you're distributing the security in a wide variety of different scenarios. And even though it's different, it's redundant. Right. Because let's say, you're prone to have your Bitcoin, stolen by a family member, right? Like let's just say that's in your lifeline, right? Or in your life. Then you have four other keys in four completely different locations. And so, yes, one gets compromised, but you're fine. You're good. Yeah, that's the beauty of redundancy.
Yeah, I just wanted, so I use Casa, I have 2 or 3 hardware keys, but I don't even know the secret phrases of the keys. Maybe you wanted to mention that because some people may be thinking that they have to say the secret phrases for each key.
Yeah, so this is kind of like a contentious topic, but Casa, we recommend a seedless setup. And what that means is that when you set up your hardware wallets, it's going to prompt you to write down the 24 words. We actually recommend that you destroy it. You destroy it. And the reason for that is, the reason for that is because in a multi-sig setup, I just kind of outlined, you know, how I would keep 5 keys safe. These are in different geographic locations. And so you're not going to be around 24/7 to keep an eye on these seed phrases. So it's very possible somebody comes across it, takes a picture of it, puts it back, and walks away. You've now been compromised and you don't even know it.
Yeah.
That's not good. Okay. But if you burn the seed phrase, at least your key is hidden and stuck inside the hardware wallet, and they have to spend the time and the resources to break it open. Okay. But again, I just want to clarify, we recommend what I call a mostly seedless setup, not a completely seamless setup. So in our system with the Casa multisig, you have 3 of 5 multisig wallet.
Right.
Casa has one, the mobile key, that's back up to the cloud, encrypted, safe, it's always recoverable. And then one of your remaining hardware wallets, we ask you to write down a key. So in the event of a catastrophe, always be able to recover your Bitcoin using the Casa key, the mobile key, and the one hardware wallet you wrote down. Go ahead.
So you got one Casa has a copy, you said, right? And then one is in a cloud somewhere?
Yeah, in your mobile phone cloud. So like iCloud for iPhones, and then Google Drive for Androids.
Okay, so basically you guys are backups, and then on a hardware device, I have my own personal one.
Yeah, you write down one seed phrase for one of them, but you have 3 devices. You have 3 hardware wallets. Yeah.
Why do I have 3 hardware wallets?
Well, okay, so this is the 3 of 5 multisig. So for the it's a different wallet. For the 2 of 3, you can keep one. You don't even have to keep that one because we have one and you have the mobile key. That's always going to be recoverable.
Gotcha.
But some people, what they do is they do the Casa key in 2 hardware wallets. In that situation, you definitely want to write down one hardware wallet.
Yeah, because if I lose that hardware wallet, then I have to come to you guys.
Yeah, exactly. That's right.
All right.
How is Casa keeping that key? Is it a hardware wallet that they're physically taking?
Yeah.
Or is it a seed phrase that they're keeping?
Yeah, we have our own security system. It's analog. It's like offline, cold. And anytime you request it, we go through the security process to actually go sign it. But it is something that we own on behalf of our clients. And
And then you pull it, they have that like live video. It's pretty intense, right?
Yeah, so if you ever request the Casa key for the 3 of 5 Multisig wallet, you hop on a video call. And so we do like a whole security process. We verify your identity. If that works out, then there's a 2-day delay. And then we'll like actually sign the signature. And the idea is if we determine that you're under duress on that video call, we're going to give you a 2-day period for the police to get to you because we're going to call your emergency contact. The emergency contact's going to call the police. They're going to get you the help that you need. And by and large, most like in-home attacks, like 95% of them, they're successful within the first, day, first like 3 to 6 hours. So the attacker knows that the longer I hold you hostage, the worse my chances are to getting out of this successfully. And so that's why we implement like the 2-day waiting period. Yeah, go ahead, Asher.
There was a story just this, like 2 or 3 days ago about, I think it was a couple that owned a hotel in Southeast Asia. I don't know if you heard about this, but they got robbed at gunpoint for their Bitcoin by a tourist who was in town and happened to know that they were Bitcoiners because they posted something on social media, and they just had a single SIG hardware wallet, got held at gunpoint, and got robbed. So it is a real threat. I mean, obviously, it's different for everybody, but it was just topical. I think that story was like 2 or 3 days ago.
Yeah,
the guy, the Jameson Law, who started Casa, keeps kind of the database of all the physical attacks that he can find. That's fine.
Yeah, that's been reported in the news. Yeah, go ahead.
If someone has a 3 of 5, you guys hold 1 key, the other 5 are.
Yeah, so you have a mobile key on your phone and then 3 hardware wallets. So that's 5 keys.
Got it.
Yeah.
If someone is doing the $5 ranch attack, they don't really need Casa's key, right?
Just
give me 2 of your hardware wallets.
Well, yeah. So there's a lot of different ways to think about it. They need to find your wallet. There's 2 ways to find your wallet. You pull the XPubs from all your keys, or you log into the Casa app, right? And so what you can do is, if you feel like someone's coming at you, you can like initiate the emergency lockdown. And then we actually like, so you won't be able to log into your Casa app.
Little panic button.
It's a little panic button inside the app.
Oh, cool.
And then we send you an email, you hop on a call. That's the only way you can unlock your account again. Mm. And it's on that call where you would kind of, we'd be able to determine that you're under duress due to our protocol. And then, and then so we would get you the help that you need.
So the panic button, does that send? That alerts you guys, but does that prevent the $5 rancher from still finding 2 of my hardware keys?
Yeah, so it prevents them from logging into the Casa app, which is the most easiest way to like take your Bitcoin out of our system. From then like if they're super competent, and not a lot of people are competent, like we are the Bitcoin pioneers in this room. And we don't, I'm just going to assume that a lot of us don't know how to recreate a multi-sig inside of an open source wallet, right? So it's, anyways, all that to say, locked out of the app, then they have to find the XPubs and the other 5 keys. They can probably grab it from the hardware wallets if you tell them the PIN to that. The next is the mobile key and the cost key, and those are the 2 hard parts. Now those 2,
mobile key can be disabled.
The mobile key can be disabled,
which leaves 3 left.
3 left, and the 3 hardware wallets they can probably rip. But then we email you the XPubs of the Casa key and the mobile key as well. Yeah, as like a backup. Yeah.
Quick mention. I'm actually a Casa member. I use the 3 of 5, and the idea is that you never have more than 2 in any one location. So the idea that somebody's going to, you know, rob you and then have you drive around to some other place, it gets more difficult.
Got it.
The other benefit of, and I maybe Andrew will explain more, but with Casa, the recommendation is only between those three wallets, you're only actually saving one set of seed words. And then the reason being is that if you, you can afford to lose one wallet or even two, and they'll send you new wallets and rotate those in, so you don't have to keep seed words for everything. But I mean, I actually use that, and I, you know, between that and a single storage, I've actually found it even easier to use and less to worry about than even a single and storage.
And if you keep your keys in, like, let's say a bank safety deposit box or like a family friend's home, you have to go there, like Alan was saying, there's going to be security guards at the bank, right? So he's not, he can't bring in a gun behind you. Like that's not usable. And that's like, that could be your out as well.
Interesting. And, yeah. And these are seedless hardware keys.
Yes.
So you have to get the physical thing.
Exactly. Okay. That's right. All right. Okay. One last question. Or comment.
Last question. Is Casa using accurate multi-sig addresses?
We will look to support that. But actually, some dude just tweeted that. Well, I think Chris from Sherpas. He wrote this like awesome post. But somebody just sent Bitcoin to a Taproot script and just it's lost Bitcoin. Yeah. It's burned. Like he can't redeem it. And so we want to be super cautious and careful with Taproot and make sure we do it the right way. There's like some things we've got to consider from like a tech perspective. Like we want to make sure our clients can retrieve their Bitcoin outside of the Casa system. Taproot, because of what it is and how you create scripts, it's like we need extra information and not just like the warehouse or whatever. You need extra information that we need to keep inside of a file and we need to send to you. And so it's a little bit extra and different. And so we just want to make sure we have a holistic perspective before we roll it out to our clients. Oh my God. Okay. We'll go 1, 2, 3 and that's it. Go ahead.
Okay. When I originally got my Bitcoin, I got it from a coin source kiosk.
Yeah.
He gave me a paper wallet.
Yeah.
So I understand that somewhere in the blockchain, this thing is sitting there and this is my, like, I guess, address and my key, right?
Yeah.
For how to get in there. Now I'm wondering, is this Bitcoin, is it loaded onto the blockchain just like that, or is it on that hard drive?
It's in the Bitcoin blockchain. All the Bitcoin exists inside the Bitcoin blockchain.
Okay. So yeah. So basically, instead of me using my paper wallet address to go in, I'm going through this like fortress of entrance.
Let me okay, so this is how I would think about Bitcoin addresses right now. A Bitcoin address is like a treasure chest. Okay. When you send Bitcoin to a Bitcoin address, you're depositing gold into this treasure chest. Each treasure chest has certain conditions that has to be met in order for it to be opened.
Okay.
So one treasure chest has one keyhole. That's your paper wallet.
Right.
That's a single key wallet. That's a lot of the wallets that people use today. One treasure chest, one keyhole. But there are other treasure chests that we can use, and that's Casa is one of them. It's multi-signature. You have one treasure chest, but with three keyholes.
Right.
And so if you put in three keys, you can unlock it and send Bitcoin out.
Wow.
So that's what those hardware wallets are. That's why we're calling it keys, because you're unlocking the script to the treasure chest to send Bitcoin out.
Right. So it's not like a treasure ledger. It's just it's a physical key of like...
Yeah, it's just a key that you're plugging in to unlock the treasure chest that's in the Bitcoin blockchain.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah.
Y'all do. Sorry, you were next.
Oh, that's good. Do you guys have recommendations on like, I'm guessing you don't, but when you do, like what either USD value that you recommend the wallet set up or Bitcoin?
Yeah, it's on our website. Actually, on our, it says like pricing. It's on our website, but I think like 2 or 3 is up to like 50,000, 3 or 5. Oh, so if you're at $50,000 worth, like you should consider a 2 or 3 multisig wallet. It's only $120 a year. If you hit like the 100K plus, I think we recommend our platinum, which is a 3 or 5. And I think it's like maybe 500,000. You should think about diamond. That's like the same 3 or 5, but like we offer like inheritance for you and stuff. So yeah. All right. So you.
That was my question. Yeah. What's your process on terms of inheriting the access to the world with and without the will, and how does that work?
So you guys get the inside scoop. We revamped our inheritance program and we're going to announce it tomorrow. But yeah, we made it so simple. Before we had people write legal contracts and all that stuff. What we do now is that you just name what we call recovery custodians. So you just name people who you want to transfer the Casa account to after you pass away. You name up to two people. And then we send them a package, and that package guarantees that they'll have access to two keys out of your Multisig wallet, out of your 305. If they have access to two keys, Casa can act as the third key, and then we'll help them recover the Bitcoin.
And then
it can be a trust.
Speaking of that, you know, the whole time frame will compare to potentially 50, 70, 80 years, first honestly. That only works assuming Casa is still gone at that percent, right? Is there a safeguard in place in case Casa, you know, I mentioned that, you know, you use a different wallet in case Casa isn't around. What about inheritance and Casa still here in 50 years?
Yeah, so that's a great question. Even if they're enrolled in our inheritance program, we'll coach them and teach them about sovereign recovery. Sovereign recovery is when you can recreate the Multisig wallet inside of Electrum. And so if Casa ever disappears, their inheritance, their recovery custodians, people that they've listed on our website, like, they will still have access to two keys, right? And so the next step is to make sure they have access to three keys. Yeah, and then they can take the Bitcoin out of there.
So it's up to the person themselves to figure out a way to pass that third key that they will need to individually access it.
Yeah, and we'll coach them too. Like as like emergency contingency plan, you know, this is what you got to do, recover your Bitcoin.
Okay.
We'll go here and then there. Okay.
If I go to Casa and I use them with all my Bitcoin and I lose it, do you give me yours or?
No. Thanks.
Is there legal issues around the inheritance thing? Like the. Let's say I designate X and Y as my inheritance custodians. Can a court get involved and then go in and say, someone else has a claim, they're leaving out, it's going to be probate or whatever. Do you guys deal with that? Like, how does...
Casa does not deal with that, and that's the beauty of you guys self-custodying your Bitcoin. Because right. We're not custodians. Yeah, right. So we're not Bank of America, we're not Coinbase or Fidelity.
You're just holding onto a key. Here's a key.
We're just holding on to the
key. Contract says the key goes to this person, that's it.
And whoever the account gets transferred to, there's no even guarantee that they can get the Bitcoin back.
Sure.
Why? Because the recovery custodian is taking custody over the Bitcoin. If they haven't properly backed up their keys, they can't get it. We give them everything they need to, and we do yearly checks to like make sure that they do. But you know, when we transfer the account, we're not giving them access to the Bitcoin. We're just giving them access to the Casa account, and that's the key differentiator.
So first, that sounds like a perfect. You got your dime with your platinum. It sounds like the inheritance is a great proof of voting accident. Strategy. Yeah, we couldn't get the sovereign, recovery right. Sorry, it's all gone. But really, what's your proof of death oracle that you use?
Yeah, death certificates and then the letter of administration from the probate court. Yeah, so if you're not in our inheritance program, then that's what we require, those two key documents. If you're in our inheritance program, then you just need the death certificate. And what that does is it allows you to avoid probate completely. Yeah. Go ahead.
Two questions. Can you set up a Casa account as a NIM? And then let's say there were some questions around identities. How do you deal with those requests, if at all?
Yeah. So if you set up as a NIM,
is it possible?
Oh, yeah, 100%. We don't KYC. We don't have to KYC anybody. You can pay with Bitcoin. So you can avoid the credit card docs point. But if you're a NIM and
what
you go to a pseudonym,
okay,
yeah, if you use a pseudonym to sign up with Casa because you don't want me to know that you have this much Bitcoin or whatever, and you don't enroll in our inheritance program, there's no way we are going to transfer the account to it. There's no way we're going to transfer the account to anybody. Because there's no way to verify that you are who you say you are. Yeah. But the cool thing is, we may be able to offer pseudonymous inheritance at the diamond level soon.
Yeah. And then, do you ever get requests from governmental authorities on your clients?
We've never gotten a single government request ever. Yeah. If there is pressure, it's going to happen at the exchange level. Not us. Yeah.
So if you guys have a system to give someone who has no knowledge of Bitcoin the key so they can get into my treasure chest. Now, what prevents from something like that happening on your end, you know, with the breach of service? You guys have
great question. We only have access to the Casa key, and that's it. So there's nothing we can do to steal your Bitcoin, no matter how hard we try, unless we showed up in front of your house and was like, show me your keys. Yeah.
But this, so in that case, how can the guy who's getting an inheritance have access to it? Because if you guys are going to send them something, you guys obviously have access to that.
Yeah, so we have one key, and the recovery custodians has two keys.
The recovery custodian.
Yeah, so you need three keys to recover the Bitcoin. So
okay.
That's, yeah.
So now in that case, you know, God forbid that the custodian's working with someone inside, some, and they find out someone's got a nice big chunk of Bitcoin, right?
Mm.
And all of a sudden it's gone. Is there insurance? How do I get protected?
Yeah. So you get protected because we only initiate the protocol if we have the death certificate.
Okay, I'm just wondering if there's anything to prevent from somebody, some scandalous person, from creating some type of way of getting in there.
Like a mole on the inside.
Yeah.
Or like if it goes into some, well, like a vault, and then only like you have the key to that vault and no one else can touch that, or I don't know, it's got your finger, but I don't know.
Yeah, so the way that our system is set up is they do have access to two keys. They have full access to one key, but we also give them the encrypted QR code mobile key backup. And what all that means is that you need to have access to your account in order to actually decrypt that second key.
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of our inheritance process. And so if you have full access to one key and you have technically half a key or whatever, or it's like a covered key, it can only be unlocked when we transfer the account to you, and we only transfer the account to that person that they have a death certificate. And then there's Casa. So even if there was like collusion, they wouldn't be able to steal your Bitcoin because they would only have full access to just two keys. Good question. All right, I want to do a quick demo, and it's going to be super fast. And then, yeah. That'd be a great job. So.